The presidential election has came and went, but we'll tell you about the results for the elected representatives in Mahaska County. The city and the school district received the results of a market study for the purpose for the proposed rec and early childhood center. CRI has the details. And four out-of-state individuals were arrested after attempting to rob a William Penn dorm earlier this week. CRI has more.
From Oskaloosa's television news source, CRI Weekly News starts right now.
Thanks for joining us. I'm Jason Madison. The 2016 presidential race has wrapped up, and Donald Trump is president-elect of the United States. Hillary Clinton won the popular vote, but she did not win over swing states like Iowa. This is the fourth time a president-elect has not won the popular vote. CRI College reporter Jeremy Esparza has more on the election results.
The 2016 election cycle has concluded with Republican Donald J. Trump being selected as president of the United States.
270 is the magic number for a presidential candidate to win the presidency, and Trump comfortably exceeded that mark. He acquired 290 of the 538 electoral votes. Democrat Hillary R. Clinton picked up 232 votes. According to CNN, voter turnout has dropped since the past two general elections. In 2008, roughly 129 million people voted in the general election. Additionally, in 2012, approximately 127 million people voted. In the 2016 election, about 120 million votes were cast. In the United States, there are almost 219 eligible voters. 46% of Americans did not partake in voting for the President of the United States. USA ranks 27th in voter turnout in the world. Belgium is number one with over 90% of voter turnout. According to CNN, Clinton won the popular vote by a margin of 947,579 votes. The last time this occurred was in the 2000 general election, when George W. Bush won the presidency but lost the popular vote to Al Gore by 540,520 votes, according to 30,000.org. In Mahaska County, 71.4% of all registered voters turned out to vote on Election Day. This is well above the national average of 58.1%. Besides the presidential election, there were also elections for the U.S. Senate. In the United States Senate race, Chuck Grassley won the race by a comfortable margin. The incumbent was first elected into the Senate in 1980, serving in the Senate for just under 36 years. 10 Mahaska County judges maintained their position. According to the Mahaska County Auditor's Office, the three highest vote-getters were Judge William S. Owens with 70% of the vote, Judge Kirk A. Daly with 69% of the vote, and Judge Joel D. Yates with 69% of votes as well. For CRI News, I'm Jeremy Esparza.
And sticking with election news, the U.S. and legislative representatives for Mahaska County were all reelected. That includes Democratic U.S. Congressman Dave Lobsack, Republican Iowa House of Representatives Guy Vanderlinden and Larry Sheets, and Republican Iowa Senator Ken Rozenboom. He will serve in his second term as senator for District 40. Excuse me, 40th. CRI caught up with Rozenboom to go over talking points for the legislature now that the House and the Senate are controlled by Republicans.
We are governing. We're in control. We have no excuses. But it also means that we're no longer playing the minority role. We are in charge of things, and I think that has a lot of responsibility attached to it. The discrepancy between, in Iowa now, between public sector workers and private sector workers is the greatest of any state in the union. We're number 50 out of 50. We have the greatest disparity between private and public wages. And that means that for our Iowans' families and Iowans' workers, that we need to take a look at tax structure. We need to take a look at how public sector employees are paid. Right at the top of the list, in general terms, is the importance to create a great economic environment for all Iowans, to stimulate economic activity, to grow the pie, so to speak. I think part of that means that we have to limit the size of state government.
Tune in to CRITV.org to find out an extended version of the interview with Rozenboom. The proposed Recreation Early Childhood Center is still in the planning phase. Recently, the city of Oskaloosa and the Oskaloosa School District hired a firm to conduct a market research to find out how the proposed recreation and childhood center will go about. CRI Eduardo Zamaripa will help us find out more.
The city and the Oskie School District want to build a new rec and child care facility, but they're also trying to figure out what to include in the facility and if the community even wants it. That's why they hired a firm to conduct a market feasibility study.
The city passed the local option sales tax, the county didn't. And so we have presumably $6+ million less of revenue to build a recreation facility, an early child care center with the school. So I think it was good for us to check back in, make sure that the numbers looked like they're supposed to, see if there really is a sampling there that drives the need for a facility like this. And the results that came back show that, yes, there is within our community.
The study cost $14,000. Triangle 2 Solutions surveyed more than 700 people on the phone from a study area not farther than 30 minutes from Oskaloosa. The survey says people want cardiovascular equipment, strength equipment, a warm water pool, and they want to keep Edmondson Pool.
Obviously, the city council had been discussing whether or not the Edmondson Pool, how does that play into this partnership, if it does at all. And the phone surveys came back quite strong that the people feel like that's still an amenity that we should have. So I think that's important for the city council to take back when they're considering what we're going to do next with this facility.
The study projects an additional 1,025 full-pay units and anywhere from 300 to 1,000 additional subsidized units if a new facility is built. A unit is defined as an adult, a couple, a family, or a senior. Those are the membership categories. It also projects an additional 381 children in the market that could enroll in the program.
We want to make sure that we're building a facility that we can afford to build and that's sustainable to the best of its ability. So I think that's exactly why we spent the additional time, the additional money to go through this reiterative process of understanding what we can, what the public wants, and then what we can afford.
CRI looked into two figures outlined by the survey. One, that the surveyed individuals had a median income of more than $89,000. According to the U.S. Census Bureau, Mahaska County has a median household income of more than $48,000. And two, that more than 70% of people who exercise do so at home. Schrock had this to say about the figures in an email to CRI. My understanding is that amount is for the study area, which is greater than just Mahaska County. No, it didn't raise any concerns. More importantly, is the information on what people are willing to pay for the services at a new facility. Additionally, the past performance of Triangle 2 Solutions has shown their methodology to be conservative and has led to numerous successes. The 70.3% number is admittedly high and is likely due to people saying, sure, I work out, when they probably don't. Again, that wasn't much of a concern. If that many people are working out at home, it points to little competition in the market and creates a challenge for us to provide options that would help them come to the facility. Not a bad thing from my perspective. For CRI News, I'm Eduardo Zamaripa.
Schrock says the city supports the project and will continue to discuss the study with the YMCA and the school district. After that, Schrock says the group will work on developing a conceptual plan within the next couple of months. Four out-of-state individuals armed with guns were arrested by the Oskaloosa Police Department after victimizing three William Penn University students earlier this week. Nobody was injured throughout the incident, but the attempted robbery was actually a targeted attack. CRI's Eduardo Zamaripa has more.
On Monday, November 14th, the Oskaloosa Police Department received a call to Penn's Watson Hall dorm around 11:30 p.m. It was then reported that the suspects left the university in a vehicle. The officers then located and stopped the suspect vehicle in the 1800 block of South Market Street, according to the OPD. The four individuals were found in the vehicle with two handguns and were each charged with three counts of first-degree robbery and possession of a controlled substance. One of the individuals was also charged with carrying weapons. Oskaloosa Police Chief Jake McGee says there were tennis shoes, Xboxes, phones, and maybe $50 in cash taken during the attempted robbery at Watson. Despite the police department identifying a total of three William Penn students being victimized throughout the incident, McGee says the incident was targeted at one William Penn student.
What we think happened is this was a retaliatory crime where the victim in the robbery was actually down in Kansas City a week or so ago. And the one of the people we arrested alleged that he took $2,000 or cash from her and they were up here trying to get the money back.
The four individuals, three male and one female, are reportedly from the Kansas City, Missouri area, according to the OPD. William Penn released the following statement regarding the incident. This was not a random incident, and one of the victims knew the suspects. We're taking the matter seriously and will promptly and thoroughly investigate this incident through applicable university channels, as well as give full cooperation to the local law enforcement. We would like to assure our students and the general public that the university campus is a safe and secure place. The university said the four arrested individuals are not affiliated with William Penn. CRI can confirm that two of the four individuals are currently enrolled at Avila University, which is located in Kansas City.
We recently became aware of the incident at William Penn University involving two of our students. And while we do not yet know the details, we are deeply concerned about the alleged behavior of these individuals. The students were not at William Penn for any university-related activities, and we are truly thankful that no one was injured during the incident.
For CRI News, I'm Eduardo Samarripa.
As of Thursday, November 17th, Chief McGee says the four individuals are still in jail. Two of the individuals have a $50,000 bond. The other two individuals have a $75,000 bond. Robbery is in the first degree is a Class B felony. Possession of a controlled substance is a serious misdemeanor. A further investigation is pending with an incident with the Mahaska County Sheriff's Office and the OPD. The Oskaloosa School Board is planning on holding a special election to fill a vacancy on the board. Last month, school board member Nicholas Hansen stepped down from his position after accepting a job in Minnesota. Hansen had 3 years left on his term. His last day was November 1st. The school board could have appointed someone to fill the position, but instead, the board will open up for a special election. The election has to happen after 60 days from the resignation, but no later than 70 days. Superintendent Russ Ryder says the special election will be held in January. Board Secretary Chad Vink says the filing of papers are due in early December. Candidates need to submit a written statement with vital information and have at least 50 signatures. The school board is looking into building a new high school softball field. The discussions began earlier this summer after the school outlined several issues with the more than 25-year-old ball field. Some of those issues include a rough playing surface, handicap accessibility, dugout conditions, and a lack of restrooms. Activities Director Ryan Parker says the 11-person committee that includes Superintendent Russ Ryder, school board member Craig Van Holzen, varsity softball coach Jay Harms, and varsity head football coach Jake Jenkins met three times leading up to the school board meeting on Tuesday, November 8th. Parker says constructing a new diamond wasn't the first idea pitched.
There's many issues, and one of our things with our committee was, is this a renovation project or is this a potentially a new construction project? There's so many issues that it was unanimous in our committee that new construction is probably the route we need to go, because at what point are you putting money into something and not getting your return?
Regarding the other teams and activities that may be affected by the potential construction of a new softball field, the committee recommends shifting everything one field down, basically relocating each team or activity one field south to make space. Before any of that happens, the committee needs to come up with a blueprint or design. School board member Carl Dross was instrumental in building several softball, baseball, and other fields out at the Lacey Complex west of town. Dross says the committee should seek out the services of a local engineering firm such as Garden & Associates to keep the costs low. Oskaloosa Superintendent Russ Ryder says this week members of the committee set out to get ideas on how to design the softball field. Activities Director Ryan Parker and softball head coach Jay Harms headed west to check out high school softball fields at West Des Moines Valley, Waukee, and Indianola. They even made plans to stop by Drake University for some added inspiration. Parker says he wants to get the project started so the construction will be completed by the summer of 2018. The property and building housing one of Oskaloosa's popular bars is up for sale. The owners of the Cellar Peanut Pub, Marty and Betsy Duffy, put their property at 206 Rock Island Avenue on the market last week. The Duffys have been in the bar business a total of 19 years and recently opened a second Cellar Peanut Pub in downtown Pella last March. Marty told CRI it was both a business and life decision to let the Oskaloosa location go. The Duffys will retain all the legal rights to the name, the Cellar Peanut Pub, and its logo. goes. Marty says selling the location will help him and his wife focus on their new business venture, future business plans, and family. The Duffys are currently balancing both bars while settling into their new home, new community, and new school district. The parents want more time together as a family these days, and feels that the two pubs will be a little too much as they settle in to get past this transition. The Oskaloosa Peanut Pub will remain open and serving the public until the property is sold. Marty says he has been contacted by several interested parties, but it is too early to know who will purchase the location. Duffy also added that he expects the new owner or owners to reopen the establishment as another tavern or lounge. Small Business Saturday began in 2010 as a way to inspire the country to support small and local businesses. Today, we are almost 1 week away from the 7th annual Small Business Saturday. In honor of Small Business Saturday, the Book Bowl in downtown Oskaloosa is hosting a local author meet and greet on Saturday, November 26th. This event that will run from 1 p.m. to 3 p.m. will feature four Mahaska County authors. Two of those published writers, Bob Hammond and Victoria Laird, are William Penn faculty members. Laird is the university's director of visual arts, and Hammond is an adjunct math instructor. Laird's book, Retrieving Adventures, is the first in a series of books describing the adventures of her two golden retrievers, Nicholas and Lincoln, in Alaska. Hammond's book, A Teacher's Tale, is a humored glimpse into the years of teaching. Other local writers that will be on hand are Ann Fender and Deborah DeYoung. The community is encouraged to support the local authors and small businesses like the Book Vault. Veterans Day has come and gone, but members of the armed forces are never forgotten. That notion was evident last week when members of the Oskaloosa community poured into Hy-Vee last Friday, November 11th, for a special event. CRI college reporter Alyssa Carey joined roughly 450 veterans, active members, and their families for the special occasion.
In honor of those in military active duty and others who've served in the armed forces, Hy-Vee grocery stores across the Midwest held several Veteran Day breakfast events. Hy-Vee and local volunteers recognize veterans every year in eight different states at 242 grocery locations, and Oskaloosa was one of them. Ben Seibert, the coordinator for this event, greeted Mahaska County's vets who came from all different branches of the military. While veterans, friends, and family members mingle, they witness a special presentation from the Quilt of Valor Foundation. The foundation gives out a handmade quilt to a deserving veteran. Osky's own Darren Alderson was this year's winner. Alderson joined the Marines right after high school in 1990 until 1994, in which he was a Desert Storm veteran. Since completing his own tour of duty in 94, Alderson now devotes his time to supporting other vets in the community.
Well, I am the post commander for the American Legion, Post 34, member of the VFW Post 2237, and what we are about is veteran service organizations. We're here for the veterans, and we fight for veterans' rights and advocacy. And then we also have four pillar practices that we preach, and that is defense, Americanism, youth, and I forgot the fourth one, but it's all about Americanism, your community, your defense, and your veterans. So. Being a member of a veteran service organization gives you that camaraderie that you have when you're in the service. And that's the same camaraderie in the Legion, because we've all been there, we all understand what everybody's going through. And that's really what the veteran service organizations are about.
Along with the breakfast, Hy-Vee ran a fundraiser where customers round up their purchases to the nearest dollar and donate the money to three different programs that help veterans: the Homefront Program, Honor Flight, and the Veteran Military Member Employee Recruitment.
The Oskaloosa community came together to support and thank those that have given us all our freedoms. Reporting for CRI News, I'm Alyssa Carey.
And here from everyone at CRI, we would like to extend our appreciation to all veterans for protecting us through land, air, and sea. Crisis Intervention Services and PFLAG Oskaloosa are holding a candlelit vigil on Sunday, November 20th at 6:30 p.m. The vigil will remember those in the transgender community who have been killed due to hate in 2016. The event will be held on the Oskaloosa City Square and will be part of a worldwide Transgender Day of Remembrance. Anyone wishing to join and participate in the vigil may either meet at the Oskaloosa Bandstand at the square at 6:30 p.m. or join the group for a short walk from St. Paul Congregational United Church of Christ to the city square. The group will meet at St. Paul at 6:15 p.m. Crisis Intervention Services provides support and empowerment to victims and survivors of domestic and dating violence and sexual assault in 12 counties across Iowa. PFLAG Oskaloosa is a local chapter of a national Parents and Friends of Lesbian and Gays organization. The group advocates for equality for all Americans. The two groups are joining forces in Oskaloosa to raise awareness of violence and harassment that transgender men and women face. Coming up next, we'll tell you why Oskaloosans will light up when they visit downtown this December. The holiday season is here, meaning Christmas baskets will be available to those in need thanks to the Oskaloosa Rotary Club. Last year alone, in its third decade of the program, Rotary and its partners provided almost 600 families in Mahaska with food baskets that fed nearly 2,000 residents. Rotary members and event organizer Andy Glover says this is the sixth year the organization has been in charge of the program.
It's great that we live in a community where we have people interested in participating in and supporting these kinds of programs, and there are large businesses and companies who are interested in helping to make sure these kinds of things are funded and get the kind of support that they need to go on.
The Christmas baskets will consist of canned goods such as corn and green beans, mac and cheese, and other prepackaged items. There will also be plenty of fresh produce, and you can't forget the ham. The amount of food within the baskets will vary in size of the family applying for the packages.
The program is funded entirely by contributions and supported through volunteer effort. There is nobody that's paid. Everything is donated. We solicit monetary contributions throughout the season that we put this program on from individuals, businesses, organizations, and clubs, and people give very generously to support this program, and then many volunteers, people in Rotary and other groups, help out with the actual preparation of the food baskets and the distribution.
The basket distribution will take place on Saturday, December 17th. Anyone interested in helping with the preparation or donating items should contact Andy Glover with the information on your screen. Oskaloosa and visitors are in for a big surprise this December. Over the last 2 weeks, a local landscaper and his crew have been trading in their daily routines for holiday themes. The group is doing its part to prepare the square for the 29th annual Lighted Christmas Parade. However, what these workers are putting up won't be coming down anytime soon.
He's not sure if he's afraid of heights yet. We'll find out.
Working two stories in the air isn't easy. Just ask Dan Bryce.
Some of the guys, yeah, they're not the happiest working on top of the buildings or off the lifts, but you know, it's just something you get used to.
That's easy for Bryce to say. The local landscaper has been in the business of stringing holiday lights on and off the ground since 2001. Bryce and his employees were hired by the Holiday Lighting Company to drape lights along the buildings in downtown Osky. Plus, he was instrumental in bringing the painting with lights concept to town.
We typically did drive-through light parks, but there just was not a space here in town to do a light park, and so we pitched the idea to the chamber. And for about 3 years, we've been working on trying to get the lights on the buildings here. We call it painting with lights.
Some of you may have seen a snapshot of the concept earlier this year during the Oskaloosa Chamber's Christmas in July event. Now it's about to get lit when 29 buildings around the square flip the switch on these LEDs.
We're doing three sides of the square plus the Midwest One Bank building. We're not going to do the courthouse. Then we're going to do the corners. So we got True Value, Musco, and the Iowa Bank building.
Bryce says he and his crew are on their second week of a three-week installation. The group is working 8 to 10 hour shifts, 7 days a week, to finish up by the end of November.
So what we're doing is we're running, we call this guy wire. So we're gonna run, we're gonna put eyelets in the mortar and then stretch the guy wire in between the eyelets. And then that's what we tie the lights to. So then we'll run lights vertically and zip tie them to the guy wire. So there's really only about 7 or 8 eyelets per building.
Bryce says there's not a single community in all of Iowa taking on a holiday lighting project such as this. In fact, the closest town is 586 miles east of Oskaloosa in Rochester, Michigan. According to Bryce, the community can see upwards of 300,000 new faces during the month of December. Rochester is entering its 11th year of putting on its big, bright light show.
What we're hoping for is to bring people to look at it. And when those people come, we want them to get out of their cars. We want them to shop. We want them to stay. And hopefully that will bring some more retail businesses back. And then hopefully this will spread. So we're not just doing the square. We want to go down each side street and start lighting buildings on each side street.
The painting with lights will illuminate the square for the first time on Thursday, December 1st at 7 p.m. when the annual Christmas parade begins. The lights will remain on in the evening for the entire month of December and a few days in January. Bryce estimates that it will cost roughly $20 per building to keep the LED lights on for the month. Also, the thousands of lights used were all paid for by the Oskaloosa Chamber through donated funds. The lights surrounding Oskaloosa's 29th annual Lighted Christmas Parade isn't the only change residents and visitors should be prepared for. Due to the construction and expansion of the Oskaloosa Fire Department, the parade route is being altered to keep everyone safe. This year's parade will start on Thursday, December 1st at 7 p.m. in the square. The Oskaloosa Police Department will be shutting down and barricading all access points to the downtown at 6:30 p.m. Handicap parking will be along 2nd Avenue East, just north of the library. The Oskaloosa Main Street and Area Chamber, law enforcement, and city officials want everyone to be safe this year and follow these friendly recommendations. There will be a strict distance policy set to keep the public far enough away from the parade route to avoid any pedestrian accidents with the floats. As a precaution, a ban on parking will be enforced on Thursday evening, December 1st, around the square. The standing area on High Avenue and First Avenue will be coned off this year in an effort to maintain a safe enough distance from floats. All onlookers should stick behind the cones, especially children. During this year's event, the throwing of candy is being discouraged. As in years past, candy should be handed to children by adults walking in the parade. The enforcement of the rule is a safety benefit, and the crowd should adhere to the recommendations. Make sure you check out the map of the new parade route at CRITV.org to be prepared for the changes. Before we get too far ahead with the holiday, Thanksgiving is next week. This means a higher number of travelers will hit the highway to see loved ones. Law enforcement agencies around Iowa and Mahaska County will ramp up patrols looking for seatbelt violations, speeders, and more. According to the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration, 340 passengers and drivers were killed nationwide in crashes during the Thanksgiving holiday in 2014. 50% of those fatalities were not wearing seat belts. In Iowa, 5 people were killed during the 2015 holiday. Officials say wearing a seat belt can reduce the risk of a fatal injury by 45%. Wearing your seat belt is the single most efficient way to prevent to save your life and the life of others. Failing to buckle up is dangerous and it's against the law. Over the weekend, William Penn and Grandview took the football field for a classic winner-take-all game. The teams were playing for a spot in the NAIA playoffs and for a Heart of America Athletic Conference North Division outright title. The Vikings got on top early and didn't let up, ending the Statesmen's 7-game winning streak 29-20. Grandview took the lead 6-0 after scoring its first drive, a few possessions later, the Navy and gold got on the board when junior fullback Amos Johnson made his way into the end zone for six. Penn didn't miss the point after and went up 7-6. Later on, the Statesmen punched the ball in to make it 14-6 at the end of the first quarter. But Grandview closed out the half strong and took a 16-14 lead into the break and never looked back, hanging on for a 29-20 win. William Penn ends its season sharing the division crown with Grandview. But the loss ended the playoff hopes for Penn. The Statesmen finished the year 7-4 and recorded a 4-1 showing in conference play. We congratulate the Statesmen on a great year. And that's the CRI news for today, November 18th. We know you have many choices for news. So from all of us at the Communication Research Institute of William Penn University, we thank you for choosing us as a local news source. Our next newscast is on Friday, December 2nd at 6:30, right here on MCG Channel 12. Have a good weekend, everyone.
Stay up to date on all the news happening in Oskaloosa by following CRI Weekly News online at www.critv.org, facebook.com/CRI Weekly News, and Twitter at CRI Oskaloosa.